Welcome to Wild and Crazy Kids, the show that goes anywhere and does anything to find kids having fun. With your hosts, Jessica Gaines, Omar Gooding, and Donnie Jeffco.
This video is brought to you by Patreon. Patreon! Put me in, coach. It's safe to say that by 1990, Nickelodeon was pretty secure in itself. With all this new studio space opening up and several very promising new shows in mid-production, the future was looking bright. But that's no excuse to go spend happy. The channel was born out of thriftiness, and it hadn't quite given that up yet. Case in point, in January of 1990, the channel introduced two shows that were both pretty cheap to produce, two shows that promoted going outside and having fun. One we've already talked about, Skate TV, one of the first television shows about skateboarding culture. The second was Wild and Crazy Kids.
The following warning has been issued regarding Wild and Crazy Kids. Exposure to Nickelodeon's All-Kid Action Challenge has been known to cause dizziness, rapid pulse, body chills, gasping for breath, involuntary vocal outbursts, furniture punching, pillow clutching, chair jumping, rug hugging hysteria. Do not go swimming or operate heavy machinery for one full hour after viewing. Wild and Crazy Kids, every weekday at 4:30, 3:30 Central on Nickelodeon. You've been warned.
Wild and Crazy Kids is as simple as they come. Gather up a group of kids and the occasional parent, put them in teams and give them matching colored t-shirts, and have them compete in a bunch of inventive and occasionally messy games, usually spun off from activities kids already love doing, and sometimes against authority. We love doing cannonballs in the pool, but usually adults get upset when we get them wet. Well, how about a contest where kids cannonball in a pool and try to get two adults in a boat the most soaked?
Oh, what's your name?
Amy.
And what's your age?
10.
All right, get them soaked. Go ahead. All right, it's thumbs up. Play game. Go. Cannonball. Oh, soaked some good. Next victim. All right.
Who doesn't love a good pickup game of baseball? But don't you hate getting in trouble when you accidentally break a window? Well, here's a game of baseball where the whole point is breaking windows.
Josh is up first for the green. He blasts it right through the left side window for a hit. All right.
Who doesn't love going to the mall? But man, there's so many rules while you're there. Well, here's a whole slew of games where you can be as loud, rambunctious, and messy in the mall as you want.
Go! Come on, go! Yeah! Red's out front coming around the first turn. Blue's right behind. Oh, yellow cuts inside!
Each episode would feature three of these contests, each one led by one of the show's three hosts, Omar Gooding, Donnie Jeffcoat, and Annette Chavez, replaced by Jessica Gaines in season two. While Wild and Crazy Kids is often lumped together with Nickelodeon's other game shows, including frequent reruns on Nickelodeon games and sports, no prizes were given out. There were no Toys R Us gift certificates, no trips to Universal Studios Orlando. These weird and wacky games were so fun, they were a prize unto themselves. Trampoline slam dunk contest? Whee! Jousting on inflatable sharks? Wahoo! Cleaning a monster truck wheel the fastest? Ah, crap, you made a chore fun, didn't you?
Ready? Set? Go!
Alright, get those wet, guys. Get those wet now. Wet that thing up.
While most episodes just stood on their own with three random games, there were the occasional themed episodes. There was an episode based around firefighting, there were beach episodes, snow episodes, an episode on a horse ranch in Utah, and my personal favorite, an episode taking place entirely at the Knights, Princesses, and Jousting themed dinner theater, Medieval Times, which was still fairly new when this show first aired.
Well, we're just gonna have to put together some kind of a special show with medieval games.
No, fare thee well, Omar.
Let the games begin and amuse my loyal subjects.
Oh my, it's this late and the games have not yet commenced.
Whatever.
There were also occasional special guests. One episode saw Michael Bauer, Venus De Milo, and Danny Cooksey from Salute Your Shorts take the role of team captains in a series of mall-themed games, including one where you're trying to knock popcorn off a kid's head from behind with beanbags, which, while not dangerous, feels like a welt waiting to happen.
We've got a clean, spotless movie theater to make a total mess out of.
I mean, Donnie, this is double the fun. Oh. Not only do we get to run wild in a movie theater, but we get the joy of trashing your team.
No, in your dreams, Michael. I'd be surprised if you guys won any of the games today.
Oh, okay, just tell me what the first game is. There'll be plenty of time for you to eat your words later.
I'm happy to report that no one was seriously hurt in the production of this show. No kids got anything worse than maybe a skinned knee. And that's kind of a miracle considering who made this show, but we'll get back to that. And then there was the episode featuring the Great American Workout, a 1991 event held at the White House front lawn to promote exercise among the youth, with Arnold Schwarzenegger there serving as President H.W. Bush's chairman to the Council of Physical Fitness.
This year's Great American Workout, the theme is youth fitness. And the reason why we make it youth fitness is because the youth in this country has a terrible problem with fitness. I never accept anything without trying it on right away, okay? So let's try it on right away to see if it fits, and then we know right away. Listen, thank you very much, guys, and I'm gonna go for another 5,000 miles of running. Okay.
Wild and Crazy Kids was a co-production between Nickelodeon and Woody Fraser Productions. Forrest Woody Fraser is one of those figures in television history that hasn't gotten a lot of recognition. The guy doesn't even have a Wikipedia page. And that's mostly because he was behind a lot of television that one might find cheap and disposable. But if there's one thing I hope Nick Next has taught you, it's that the cheap and the disposable is just as important as the big hits. He's also one of those self-aggrandizing characters that make it hard to sort out fact from fiction. He's known to stretch the truth. For example, on his still-up tripod website from 2009, he listed Wild and Crazy Kids as top-rated kids show, now on its 13th season, which is, very wrong. It's kinda hard to sort the truths from the lies on this guy, but I'll do my best. Woody Fraser got his start as a director for NBC in the late 1950s. In 1961, he and big band singer Mike Douglas co-created The Mike Douglas Show, starting as a local Cleveland program before becoming the first syndicated daytime talk show in 1963. Daytime talk shows would be Fraser's bubble for a while, working on The Dick Cavett Show, The Della Reese Show, The Virginia Graham Show, and The Richard Simmons Show. He was also a producer on Good Morning America, but wasn't one of their creators, despite what his LinkedIn page says. Good Morning America started in 1975. Fraser didn't join until 1976. By his own account, Woody Fraser was a very hands-on producer, not just the money man, but a creative, along with the writers and directors on his shows. Well, there are in this business two kinds of producers. The first, the executive type, who doesn't get involved creatively in what happens on the screen. He's interested in such things as the budget, in travel arrangements, and how much a certain prop costs. He's a detail kind of guy, an overseer. The second is the guy who becomes actively involved in the show all the way, including while it's being taped. I enjoy that part of being a producer. I like the feeling of getting a good ideal for a show and then executing it, not trusting it to someone else's taste of discretion. So, you know how in talk shows you'll often have segments featuring, let's say, animals doing stunts, or people demonstrating weird talents, or just general oddities like, here's Vincent Price, and he's gonna show us how to cook fish in a dishwasher. You know, that sort of thing. In the 1980s, Woody Fraser started making shows that was just that stuff. Those amazing animals, life's most embarrassing moments. That's incredible. Hours of cheap, disposable, trash television. That's Incredible in particular gained some infamy when people performing various stunts kept getting hurt. Stanley Crummell burned his hand so bad while demonstrating a supposedly fire retardant suit that he spent 2 years in rehab. Steve Lewis, whose gimmick was jumping over speeding cars, had his left leg go through a windshield. motorcyclist Gary Wells tried to jump the fountain at Caesar's Palace, a stunt that Evel Knievel couldn't pull off, and Wells couldn't pull it off either, suffering two broken legs, a broken pelvis, and a torn artery. These were not professional stuntmen, and the show drew a lot of heat from the Hollywood organization Stunts Unlimited. My feeling is that That's Incredible has been negligent. Nobody is drawing the line on what's safe and what isn't. They're hiring daredevils and not stuntmen, and we resent that they're calling them Hollywood stuntmen. If they keep it up, eventually somebody will get killed. I feel like, maybe, when you claim to be a very hands-on producer, and you've made a show that's nearly killed a bunch of people, you probably shouldn't be allowed anywhere near children's television. But it's from That's Incredible that we start to find the origins of Wild and Crazy Kids, as the series had a segment called Incredible Kids, showing off children performing amazing feats, and kids watching at home hated it. What we did discover was that kids didn't want to see other kids doing amazing, impossible things. They wanted to see things that they could do. Essentially, Frasier was learning a lesson that Nickelodeon was also learning around the same time in the early 1980s. When Nickelodeon showed off talented children on programs like Going Great, they found that all this did was discourage kids watching. It made them feel inferior. Why should I even try? While Frasier had worked very little in children's television, he was nonetheless in a parallel track of thought with Nickelodeon. Woody Frasier Productions pitched Wild and Crazy Kids to Nickelodeon, and production began in the latter half of 1989.
Scott from Great Scott has to be more than ambidextrous when he's challenged to use his butt to sign his name, Wild and Crazy, this Monday at 6:30, 5:30 Central on Nickelodeon.
Wild and Crazy Kids was a rare West Coast show for the channel. A majority of it was shot in San Bernardino in California, just east of Los Angeles, with filming taking place during the summer to take advantage of all the kids who didn't have to go to school. Having so many regular people involved in actual location shooting, playing these very elaborate games, was a challenge to shoot. We had a lot of organizational issues, and I don't mind saying that. The production company did a good job, but there were some times when they really pushed our hours as young people. It was one of these things where I'd show up and they'd go, this game is going to work just like this, and this will explode at this time, and it would be a complete major failure. We'd have to, a lot of times, have backup games planned, which always threw the day off. We shot two shows a week. It was a lot for everybody. The hosts were young local actors, not the everyday normal kids thing Nickelodeon had been doing with shows like Rated K and Don't Just Sit There. And upon re-watching the show for this video, I was surprised to realize that these kids are actually playing characters, sort of. Omar Gooding came from a show business family. You're probably familiar with his older brother, Academy Award winner Cuba Gooding Jr. And his father, Cuba Gooding Sr., was the lead singer of the soul group The Main Ingredient. Everybody plays a fool sometimes. On top of running these games, Omar Gooding is playing what I can only call a mad trickster god, claiming to build all these wild devices used in the games and using actual magic powers to play pranks on the other hosts.
Well, let's see you slam dunk it, Omar.
Okay, yeah.
If you say so.
How does he do that?
The magic of television.
Focus, focus, Alakazoo. Send us all back to 1092.
Gooding's mother was a frequent presence on set, keeping an eye on things, and sort of became a production mom for the rest of the cast. Omar Gooding's mom was always on set and was very much a big part of his career back then. It was nice to have her there, because my parents weren't really around, and she did take care of us quite a few times. Omar Gooding would sometimes turn and walk away from me because his mother had said at the start of the season, "Don't make her upset, she has a job to do and she is sensitive." Donnie Jeffcoat had a lot of work under his belt already, appearing in movies like Ghoulies 2 and Night of the Demons, and guest appearances on shows like Punky Brewster, Who's the Boss, and three episodes of The Wonder Years. On Wild and Crazy Kids, Jeffcoat played the straight man to Gooding's little gremlin, often getting pies thrown in his face and slime dumped on his head.
Listen, all I know is I'm very happy to be away from you and your pies.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Wait a minute, Omar. You actually think I'm stupid enough to call out a number like 2? Alright, so I take it that when you get dumped on, you're out of the game.
You're out, Donnie. Now go hit the showers and take the rest of the dummies with you.
I was the one on Wild and Crazy Kids who got picked on, because I think Omar Gooding was protected by his mom half the time, so she would never let them do half the stuff they did to me to him. Anytime there was a stunt or something crazy messy, it was usually done to me. By the last season, I started complaining. Really? At 10 o'clock in the morning, you're going to dump that vat of crap on me? Annette Chavez was a former children's pageant competitor and a frequent actor in commercials.
Swimming is not only fun, it's great exercise and it's good for the body. And in just a few minutes, 9 wild and crazy kids will be putting their swimming skills to the test in a funny and exciting swimming pool relay race.
Now this was a good foot in the door for her. She would go on to be a regular on General Hospital for a time. I'm glad she got the opportunity. However, her casting might have been a bit short-sighted on Nickelodeon's part. Chavez was 17 when she was cast, the oldest of the three, meaning that by the end of production on the first season, she was already in the process of graduating high school and starting college. She came into the show already aging out of the show. So for season 2, Chavez was replaced by Jessica Gaines.
If you've ever tried the limbo, then you know how tough it is. And I'll bet you were doing it on solid, dry ground. Well, today we're going to take the game of limbo one step further with our ski limbo slalom.
Before Annette left, we had the Latin, the African American, and the white boy on Wild and Crazy Kids. So I was kind of surprised they didn't get another Hispanic lady to fill Annette's shoes. Gaines had come out of theater, her father being a former off-Broadway performer and was at the time a Hollywood casting director. Being the youngest of the cast and a girl had its own, unique challenges on set. Sometimes it was shocking how much we'd get one crew person who would be clueless. There was one time where they said, put them in their spaces. One of them thought it would be funny to say, Jessica's in her hole. I heard it. And everybody who heard it, their jaws dropped. One person said, what are you doing? She's a minor. Do you want to get sued? Those incidents are scarring. Young girls can't handle that. Wild and Crazy Kids wasn't the biggest production nightmare we've covered on Knacks, but it did seem sloppy and troublesome at times, and I think it only worked out because the core concept was so simple and easy. The show premiered as a one-off special on Nickelodeon on January 13, 1990, then began airing regularly on the 4th of July, 1990, in parallel with Skate TV. But Skate TV had a very niche audience. Wild and Crazy Kids was a lot more universal, and stood the test of time much longer, running for 3 seasons, 65 episodes. Like a lot of Nickelodeon game shows, there was a version that went on the road in 1992, with Gooding, Jeffcoat, and Gaines splitting up and hosting Wild and Crazy Kid events at local malls and theme parks. After that, the show went into 8 years of reruns, airing on Nickelodeon all the way up through April 30th, 2000. That's a long time for reruns. Even Pinwheel only got 6 years. But the show has a timeless appeal to it. Outside of that one time the elder President Bush showed up, and maybe the frequency in which shopping malls were featured, it doesn't feel that dated rewatching it in 2022. What does feel dated, however, was the reboot they made in 2002.
Hey, what is up, guys? Matt here, hanging out with my co-host, Bodie Miller, 2-time Olympic silver medalist.
Check us out here at Wild and Crazy Kids at Camp.
Yeah!
Wild and Crazy Kids. Yeah! Coming up next.
Only on the network where Wild and Crazy Kids rule, Nickelodeon.
First up, it's slip and slide, plus a helicopter ride. Next, we do a slam dunk from a skateboard. Then it's time to launch some whack balls on our special episode of Extreme Whack.
Produced once again by Woody Fraser and premiering on July 29th, 2002, the updated Wild and Crazy Kids isn't that different from the original in content. Kids play wacky games and parents get all messed up. But the devil's in the details. Instead of three fellow kids as hosts, the 2002 version is hosted by very much not a kid, Maddie Malaleo, who was an on-air personality for Nickelodeon Games and Sports. He would be joined by guest hosts, usually child performers, here to promote their latest movie or TV show or album. People like Alex Vega and Daryl Sabera from Spy Kids, Jeffrey Lacone and Alvin Alvarez from The Brothers Garcia, and the late Aaron Carter, which still feels weird to say. So already you've got this level of separation with the young audience now that there's a grown-up in the room, and you're dating yourself with these pop culture promotions. It also has a bit of that extreme flavor that dates a lot of early 2000s productions. In the original Wild and Crazy Kids, you might get to hit your mom in the face with a cream pie. In the new Wild and Crazy Kids, you might get to dump flour on your mom from a helicopter. Plus, the new theme song was just incredibly inferior to the original. The original theme was one of the best pump-you-up jams of the decade. The 2002 theme barely had any energy, which is interesting because they're both credited to Woody Fraser's go-to composer, Wendy Fraser. I know what you're thinking, and the answer is probably, but I'm not sure. She's probably his daughter. I cannot confirm that. All I know is that he had 8 kids. I don't know their names. What I can confirm is that this is the same Wendy Fraser who sang on Patrick Swayze's song, She's Like the Wind. Just a fool to believe. In any case, Wild and Crazy Kids 2002 only lasted one season, airing its last on May 25th, 2003. There have been no home video releases of either version, and episodes tend to come and go on YouTube and other video sites. The franchise has been completely dormant for the last 2 decades, and that's kinda surprising. It's a very simple idea, very cheap to produce, and there has been a lot of nostalgic value from the now adult millennial generation. You'd think with Double Dare and Rugrats coming back, a new Wild and Crazy Kids would be a no-brainer. Perhaps there's an entanglement in the rights. Perhaps they legally can't make it without Woody Fraser's involvement. And over the years, that has become a far less appetizing proposition. Fraser continued to make plenty of shows into the 90s and 2000s, including another one for Nickelodeon, What Would You Do?, which we'll be getting to fairly soon. But the shows never lost their trashy edge, including some of the less popular early reality shows like Ultimate Revenge and Extreme Fakeovers. And then in 2008, he produced that god-awful Mike Huckabee show for Fox News. Yeah, Fraser is a big friend of Fox News. Interesting fact, Woody Fraser gave future Fox News CEO Roger Ailes his first job in television. And they had another thing in common. In 2012, Fraser began working for Hallmark, returning to the daytime talk show format with Home and Family. In 2018, a number of sexual harassment complaints against Fraser were made from people who worked with him at Hallmark. Complaints that resulted in the terminations of several people who either made the accusations or stood up for those who made them. Fraser would eventually be removed from the show's production, and he hasn't made anything since. So yeah, I probably wouldn't bring back Wild and Crazy Kids under those circumstances either. Not for a channel that's still kinda struggling on how to handle things like Dan Schneider's legacy. And that's a shame because it was a very fun show. A show that was easy to imagine yourself on. A show that, if you were the right age, you might try to replicate in your own backyard. I certainly tried. Sure, it was slight. Sure, it was cheap. But it was charming and it was fun. A summer's day of a show.
Nick, 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 Nick,
Nickelodeon.
Nick, 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 Nick,
Nickelodeon.
Next time. Speaking of summer days, we're going back to camp. But this time, I promise it'll be a lot more fun than Camp Run Amok. Today's research shoutout goes to Slimed, an oral history of Nickelodeon's Golden Age. I brought up this book a few times before, and it probably has the most direct behind-the-scenes information you can get about wild and crazy kids. Thank you all for watching. If you like support Knacks and other Pop Arena projects, consider contributing to my Patreon. Every dollar goes to production values, research materials, and the electricity bill. It's going to be a cold winter. Remember, if you can get the Patreon up to $1,000 per video, I'll start covering Nick at Night shows. You can also support the channel by liking the video, subscribing, hitting that bell icon for notifications, leaving a comment, following me on social media, sending a one-time donation through PayPal or Ko-fi, and sharing Knickknacks with all your friends. I'll see you next time, and remember, Black Lives Matter.